All right, it's a great pleasure to once again have Dr. Pushpak Bhattacharya here. He is a director of IIT Delhi, IIT Patna, and he also has been professor for about 25 years at IIT Bombay or IIT Mumbai. He's undoubtedly among the best, maybe the best known NLP researcher in India, and he was the past until last year. He was the past president of ACL, the main group in NLP area. So that's quite an honor. If earlier we were discussing, and he reminded me, in our department, we don't have extensive coursework in NLP, but there are some wonderful video lectures, and a number of them are from him on NLP. Last year, when he was here, he talked about machine learning and NLP. With IIT Patna, we are also hoping to start a joint master's program that involves students doing 1 year in Patna and then 1 year here, where the student will largely be doing thesis. So let's see if that happens. And we have a MOU, Shweta, who has come here for doing research, and we hope that she will come back again here. There's a lot of exciting work that goes on. The research culture that Dr. Bhattacharya has developed in IIT Patna is amazing. I was really impressed with what I saw when I had the chance to visit there. So again, we welcome him here after his talk and later on in the day. So at 2 o'clock, he's going to meet some PhD students who might have interest in academic careers in India. And then after that, we'll have meetings with each of our, a group of students doing different projects, and I've asked them to prepare, short presentations for him and present to him what we do and get the feedback and so on and so forth. If I can't finish all those things, then we'll continue tomorrow morning. We'll leave here tomorrow at about noon, so we'll be here another couple of hours tomorrow. Yeah. Okay? So with that, let me invite Dr. Bhattacharya here.
Okay, so good morning to all of you, and it's very nice to be back here. I was here last summer. So today I have taken this topic, namely automatic detection of sarcasm. And it is always very nice to meet Amit. He is a world-renowned figure in computer science and engineering, and it's intellectually very stimulating to meet him and talk to him. I thank you for this opportunity. Anyway, so I'm with two institutes now, IIT Patna and IIT Bombay. And just 2 seconds for each of the institutes, Natural Language Processing Group, which I'm sort of mentoring and have created. So this group in IIT Bombay, the lab is called Center for Indian Language Technology. We do work in NLP with a lot of focus on Indian languages, which have their own properties and characteristics. So this group has 5 faculty members, 3 from computer science, 2 from linguistics, and about 40 people from as PhD students, research staff, master students, and so on. And the other group, which is relatively new, which I'm mentoring, is the NLP group in IIT Patna. And again, there are 3 faculty members and about 20-25 students, research members, and so on. Now, the topic of the discussion today is on a chain, okay, which is artificial intelligence to NLP, to sentiment, to sarcasm, and then a special kind of sarcasm, which is numerical sarcasm. So everything happens in the context of artificial intelligence, and you know, since the beginning of computer science, starting with Turing, human beings have always investigated the question of automated intelligence. So NLP is a part of artificial intelligence. So I'll talk about the main challenge of NLP, which is ambiguity processing, in the beginning part of the talk, to contextualize our problem, the problem of sarcasm detection. Then sarcasm detection is a part of sentiment analysis, which again is a part of natural language processing. And all these problems need use of machine learning, which needs feature engineering. And there is a cognitive dimension to this kind of automation, which I'll talk about.
And so,
yeah.
As I heard you say, which requires feature engineering, and our group is also writing a paper on feature engineering in Twitter.
Mm-hmm.
However, yesterday, day before yesterday, we were watching an interview with Yoshua Benigo.
Benjio.
And on deep learning and how feature engineering is no longer needed for that kind of stuff.
Yes, yes.
Very
yes,
interesting.
Yes. Yeah, yeah. I'll have some observations on that later. So natural language processing is known to be a multi-layered problem. Okay, so we start with morphology at the lowest level, which is processing of words, breaking the words into their lemma, suffixes, extracting features from words themselves. Okay, quickly, for example, has quick as the stem and li as the suffix, which indicates that this is an adverb. Now, afterwards comes the layer of part of speech tagging, which gives grammatical categories to words, noun, verb, adjective, within nouns again, proper noun, within proper noun again, named entities like place name, organization name, and so on. Chunking is grouping of words, the blue sky, for example. Okay, it's a simple phrase. Then we move on to parsing, which is creation of a tree-like structure from the linear order of words sentence. Then we move on to semantics, which insists on word sense disambiguation, semantic roles, and finally pragmatics and discourse, which are really very difficult problems. And sentiment analysis, sarcasm are problems of the highest complexity. They fall in the domain of pragmatics. And if we deal with sarcasm in a context, in a dialogue, for example, then discourses also have to be taken into account. The other picture of NLP is that it is a multi-dimensional problem, and three dimensions are very important, namely the language axis, Hindi, Marathi, French, English, Tahiti. These are different languages, they have their own properties. And the problem axis is the problem involving language and text. Algorithm axis is the axis of techniques for solving these problems. And computational linguistics deals with creation of algorithms for solving problems for the language. The language axis is many times not kept in mind. I know a lot of NLP is really English-centric, but that can be deceptive. Okay? There are languages which have very different properties than English. Languages have a lot of morphological complexity, for example. So unless we deal with morphological complexity, segment into morphemes, then NLP of those languages are ineffective, so to say. And we'll also see that sarcasm, sentiment, these are very culture specific. There are cultures where sarcasm is looked upon as lying, okay, and is looked upon as a kind of sin. I was talking to somebody from Europe, and she said that she could never understand sarcasm until at a later age, because sarcasm is looked upon as lying. Okay. So if you mean opposite to what is there on the surface, then it is a kind of wrong practice. So there are cultures which believe that sarcasm is not right. On the other hand, sarcasm is as old as Aesop's fables. Okay, Aesop himself went to Lydia and he was stoned to death. Okay? He was pelted with stone, and that's how he met with his death, because he was extremely sarcastic in his observation of what people do there. So sarcasm is really very old. So the need for NLP does not need any more description. We know that opinion mining is a very live problem. We need to know sentiments of people when they deal with organizations, leaders of institutes, political figures, and so on. And translation industry, we know, is growing at a very rapid rate. 37 billion-dollar business by 2020. So these are very live and important natural language processing problems. Machine learning and NLP have come very close to each other nowadays, and I depict this by this picture from India, picture of wedding. Okay, and we do not know who the groom, who the bride are. Okay, but the point is that NLP and machine learning marriage has led to very interesting possibilities, very interesting results. But what is machine learning really? So if you're given the concepts of, given the instances of tables, for example, which are positive examples, then we learn the abstract notion of tableness. Okay, we are not learning instances of table, but we learn a very intriguing thing. Very intriguing thing called tableness. So this is something which we keep in mind. And many times we arrive at a rule which can have positive, false positives and false negatives, referring to fall in precision and fall in call. So NLP machine learning marriage is very good. And this particular point has to be kept in mind. Sarcasm is a problem where a lot of machine learning is used. Now, natural language processing is really ambiguity processing. The reason why NLP is challenging is because there is ambiguity at all levels. Lexical ambiguity, ambiguity of words. The word present, for example, can be noun, verb, adjective, and it can have multiple meanings, like present time. Present can also mean a gift. There can be structural ambiguity. I just saw this poster in one of the houses, you know, when I was coming to Ohio. One and two bedroom flats, move-in ready. Okay, move-in ready is an adjective, which is a qualifier for the flat. And move-in ready has to be parsed this way. It's not an easy NLP problem. Semantic ambiguity, flying planes can be dangerous, is a classical sentence in linguistics. What is dangerous? The act of flying or the objects themselves, the flying planes themselves. Pragmatic ambiguity, this is where sarcasm begins. I love being ignored after a party while taking leave of the host. The host never paid attention to me, let's say. And I would be sarcastically saying, I love being ignored. So this is the picture. NLP has to deal with ambiguity. And ambiguity means multiple possibilities. And we have to choose one amongst these options. And this makes NLP a machine learning problem, because we are deciding amongst many possibilities. And this is the classification task. So the other challenge of natural language processing is that there are many languages in the world. This is a reality. And multilingual computation has to be arranged for. We have to deal with multiple languages and their properties. So now, some of the moot points are, when should we use rules, and when is it that we cannot create rules? Okay. So one of the slogans in machine learning, NLP, whole of AI, is that do not learn when you know. Okay. If we know a clear, succinct rule, which has high precision and high recall, why should we bother with processing of data? Okay. Why should we do machine learning? The rule is very clear. Just encode this rule in the software and get your work done. So we should not learn when we know. But when this phenomenon is arbitrary, okay, there is no apparent underlying regularity or rule, then we cannot do better than learning patterns from the data, and which is where machine learning comes into picture. So when you're translating from Hindi to English, let's say, and we have the phrase "bahut dhanyavad," okay, which is translated as "many thanks." It is never translated as "several thanks," even though "bahut" can be translated as "several," okay, and many other adjectives. So there is a frozen expression which is "many thanks," and that has to be learned from the data. Okay, there is no reason why we can't say several thanks. So in this scenario, probability plays a very interesting role. Okay, so this is a new, it is a relatively new understanding of how to do NLP, and also computer vision, and also speech, many other activities of AI. So if you look at these four sentences, the sun rises in the east, the sun rises in the east, the SVN rises in the east, the sun rises in the west. So all these sentences except the first one has some mistake or other. The second sentence is grammatically wrong, the third sentence has spelling mistake, the fourth sentence is semantically odd. Okay? The fourth sentence is okay metaphorically. Okay? Shakespeare was born in England and the sun rose in the west in the literary sky, for example. So you can have a metaphorical sentence of this kind. But other sentences have problems of syntactic or spelling error. The amazing thing is that when we calculate the probability of these strings of words, what does probability mean? The probability of occurrence of this sentence in the corpora, spoken and written corpora. And this sentence may not occur as such in the corpora. So we take parts of the sentence, apply chain rule of probability, use Markov, you know, independence assumption, and get the probability as product of bigrams, trigrams, n-grams, and so on. Okay? And this is such an effective way of doing NLP. This is called language modeling, and has produced enormous amount of success. Okay? Though shallow in its processing power, it has produced results. So it will come out that this probability of the first sentence is highest amongst all the sentences given. So since it's coming out as the highest scoring sentence, does it mean that the computer is understanding that other sentences have syntactic mistake or semantic mistake or spelling mistake? No. It is only computing probabilities through frequency of different n-grams. Okay, such a simple thing can deliver. So this is also illustrated by a very famous paper in 2014 from Google, which got a lot of press at the time. And this was automatic captioning of images. Okay? So things like this could happen. If you take a look at the second picture, two dogs play in the grass. So everything is okay about this caption except the number of dogs. Okay? So this is, since the early age of AI we know, this is the sign of shallow understanding. Okay? Systems that have shallow understanding do very well in certain parts of the task, but they can also make very stupid mistakes. So a system that is able to detect grass, so to say, detect, quote unquote, detect the activity of playing, how can it make a mistake in the number of dogs? Okay? So this shows that the understanding is shallow. But it is very effective, very fast, and does the job approximately well. So the reason why this has happened, I mean, instead of three dogs, two dogs, is because most probably in the training data, there is no pattern, three dogs. Okay, dogs always come with the number two, for example. So the system can only caption making use of what it has seen before in the training data. Similar is the case with last but one figure, a red motorcycle parked on the side of the road. So this is not a red motorcycle, but a pink motorcycle. Okay, and everything else is right about the picture. So this kind of very impressive performance by system is orchestrated by one paradigm, the paradigm of correspondence. Okay, and you know, so much of machine learning is captured by this paradigm. There are two objects, object A and object B, which are in correspondence, and then we build correspondence between parts and features from object A and object B. Okay. And this correspondence, which is built, which is also probabilistic, is used in a new situation. That activity is called decoding. So correspondence building, probability of correspondence, and decoding in a new situation, applying scoring mechanism. This is the ruling paradigm of machine learning. It is useful in machine translation, useful in summarization, useful in query expansion, and name any activity in NLP. This is the paradigm. And in this case, what is happening is the objects which are in correspondence are captions and pictures. On the picture side, we do image processing. On the caption side, we do natural language processing. And then put correspondences. So that's all. Okay?
This involves some work in generating the language, meaning proper formulation of the sentence and all that, right?
So decoding, of course, yes. So decoding has to be done where parts of objects are put together and then scored, and you pick up the highest probability sequence.
And they would probably have used you know, very large corpus of sentences to
tremendous,
see how
yeah.
I will take this conception, put together in a sentence that makes sense.
Yeah, so billions of pictures and their corresponding levels. So there is no intriguing activity other than this kind of correspondence building.
So how they label, I mean, it's...
How they label, so you take a new picture, for example. Let's say we take this picture, little girl in a pink that is blowing bubbles. So you can already see that there are problems in the LLP construction. Who is blowing bubbles? Okay. So these segments like a little girl in a pink that is blowing bubbles, these segments come from the data, from the training data.
Mm-hmm.
And there are features extracted from the image. Those features have those corresponding pieces of text from other pictures, okay? And then when a new picture comes in, after extraction of image processing features, we see that some features correspond to this segment of text. Other features correspond to another segment of text. And then you put them together.
Okay.
This is borrowed from the idea of machine translation. Okay, if we take sentences in language L1 and then we get the corresponding translation parts for L2. For a new sentence, we put these together and score them by probability. That's all.
Okay.
That's all.
Okay. So for the image also, do they generate actually a tree kind of thing with the objects
and
other
things? That's right. Yes.
But obviously, some part of information is missing.
Yeah, sure. Which is why we have these mistakes. Two dogs play in the grass.
Or the other guy in the photo is missing.
And it could have syntactic problems also. The sentence can be ill-constructed. So this is a very powerful paradigm. So much of NLP is based on this paradigm. Okay. The other point is that natural language processing needs annotated corpus. Raw text has a lot of disorder. Raw text is high entropy. The reason is that there is ambiguity at every level. Words have ambiguity, phrases have ambiguity, okay, pragmatic ambiguity, which we talked about some time back. So a lot of ambiguity is reduced through annotation. So past speech tag annotators, for example, sit down and annotate words as noun, verb, adjective, adverb, and so on. Pieces of text can be annotated as sarcastic, non-sarcastic, positive sentiment, negative sentiment. So this kind of annotation is done by human beings. And then the annotated data is passed through machine learning. Now, good annotators are difficult to come by. Annotators need understanding of linguistics and language phenomena. They also need understanding of statistical processes. Okay? And in particular, people who design the tag set, let's say part of speech tag set and so on, they have to understand both these sides, both statistics and linguistics. So we move on to sentiment analysis. In 2010, there was this definition from Bing Liu, which has stayed in the field. A sentiment analysis problem is defined by means of a 5-tuple. We are actually interested in the third quantity, which is S-O-I-J-K-L. This is the sentiment of the ith opinion holder, H-I is the opinion holder, the fourth entity, at time T-L, on an object OJ, on an aspect K, FJK of that object. So this would mean, for example, if I say the songs in the movie were bad, okay, then the opinion holder is I, HI is I. I'm talking of the present time, so TL is present time. The sentiment is negative. The feature is song, an object is movie. So this is a 5-tuple definition of sentiment analysis. All the tuples have to be carefully encoded in the feature engineering. Sentiment analysis is a multidimensional problem. You can have algorithms like rule-based, unsupervised classification, SVM-like classifiers. The sentiment can be at the level of document or sentence and aspect. That's the granularity of sentiment. It can be for a language like English or Hindi or Chinese, because sentiment differs from language to language. Japanese, Chinese, Korean people, CJK countries, they are extremely moderate in their use of adjectives. Intense adjectives are hardly used. Okay, whereas in California, we see adjectives are most of the time very strong. Everything is amazing, astounding. Okay, people use strong adjectives there. So sentiment differs from culture to culture, language to language. Features also can be discourse based, syntactic dependency based, bag of words based. Okay, then the sentiment can be expressed by means of ordinal values. When we look at movie reviews and say 5-star, 4-star, 3.5-star, these are ordinal values of sentiment. Discrete polarities and subjectivity. So sentiment can be, you know, encoded in many different forms. And a lot of resources are used, like dictionaries, seed set, ontology, which require time and money to build. But in spite of all kinds of complexity involved in sentiment analysis, okay, which is one of the very most challenging problems of NLP, the flow of computation seems to be very uniform and similar across problems, which is take input text, do feature extraction, run it through classifier, use lexical resources, and out comes the sentiment as positive, negative, or neutral. This is the classical machine learning oriented view of sentiment analysis. And as Amit said, this feature extraction part will possibly get obviated by the use of deep learning. We'll see it towards the end of the talk. And there are many challenges in sentiment analysis. Sarcasm is something I will talk about. I suggest you wear your perfume with windows and doors shut. There is no negative sentiment word here, okay? But the inherent sentiment is that of negativity. This is sarcasm. So-and-so falls 284 runs short of what would have been a fourth class triple century. So this is also a convoluted way of saying that the person made only 16 runs. The movie may have nicest actors, a talented music director of worldwide acclaim, and the most expensive set one has ever seen, but it fails to impress. So there is a final damaging statement which has negative words, but the rest of the words are all positive sentiment based. So this is a difficult problem in machine learning. There are lots of positive features, but one damaging statement. This is called thwarting. Nature of the text can be not very non-standard in sentiment analysis. And there is domain specificity. He is a deadly football player. There is a positive opinion about the player. But the campus has deadly snakes. There is a negative opinion about the campus. So the same word can have both positive and negative usage. Now I produce this table simply to say that the sentiment analysis accuracy figures have hovered around 75-80, you know, over many years. Over 15-20 years, this is the kind of figure that you see. Another very noteworthy thing is the first row, where a very simple classifier like knife base, okay, and unigram features produce high baseline, 78.7. And this kind of baselines are difficult to beat. Okay, in spite of investing lots of resources, annotated data, sophisticated classifier, the accuracy figure does not go beyond, let's say, 80, 85, and where the baseline is 78.7, with a very simple scheme of unigram-based features and classifiers. So this is a predominant concern in whole of NLP.
Have people focused on what exactly goes wrong and then just focused on addressing what goes wrong?
So you're talking about error analysis, really. So incisive error analysis has been done.
Yeah, they do that. The question is, do they say, okay, here is, through error analysis, I understand these are the situations in which I'm wrong. I will treat them differently. Maybe I'll do rules for them, or I'll do something, you know. So
I can throw some light on that. See, what happens is that, let's say you go from unigram to bigram, to trigram. So you take longer pieces of text. And you hope that this is more information, so will be more helpful. The key point is that in NLP, more information always comes with the possibility of drift. Okay, you bring in more information. A part of this information will help, another part will not help. This will mislead. Okay, so when we take more words in the n-gram, those additional words, new words, come with their own ambiguity. Okay, and that can be misleading.
But on the other hand, actually, n-gram models, ordering or syntactic embedded in the language. So, which I think that's very important features for the, especially Sarkozy software.
So, so IR people, for example, people who are from information retrieval, they would say that, yes, it is very intuitive. I mean, you do deep semantic analysis, do parsing, do dependency analysis, and this should be helping a search engine. Okay, it's a query which is parsed into its syntactic structure, semantic role is taken. Then we have removed a lot of ambiguity from that query. Now we pass it through a search engine, get documents from the web. Do we get better results? No. Most of the time, no. Okay. So this dependency-based, relationships, semantic roles, very intricate disambiguation. The return on investment is not very good in many fields. Okay. So very simple language models, very simple shallow processing seems to deliver the result, and the return on investment is high there. Okay. So there are problems where deep semantic analysis would help, and there are many problems where this doesn't help. In fact, it misleads. So maybe the analogy would be to computer vision, where the lower level processing of image, like edge detection, for example, shadow detection, etc., are done well by statistical means. But category formation, is this a table, or is this a chair, or is this the face of a dog, etc., etc. Higher level category formation requires knowledge. So a lot of NLP task has a part of it which should be done by statistical means, and data-oriented models. Higher level category formation would require rules and word knowledge and so on and so forth.
So what about sarcasm subject or sentiment analysis?
Yeah, so we'll go ahead and see, who plays what role. Yeah. So this diagram brings home an important point that simple features and simple classifiers often create baselines which are difficult to beat. So we move to sarcasm. The word sarcasm comes from the Greek word sarcasmos, the scary meaning, to tear flesh with teeth. And the Sanskrit root is vakrokti, which means a twisted utterance. Vakra is twisted, ukti is utterance. So sarcasm is very old, as I've said before, 500, 600 years before Christ, people used to use sarcasm. Now, the foundation of sarcasm is irony, which means opposite of what is on the surface. That is the meaning of irony. And sarcasm is a kind of irony, where the surface meaning is different from the underlying meaning. But sarcasm is always hurtful. It is always meant to ridicule and hurt. Okay? That is the additional dimension of sarcasm. Now, there are many different kinds of sarcasm which have been studied. So, propositional, embedded, like prefix, and illocutionary. The fourth kind of sarcasm is important because this involves cognitive features. It involves language. So, shrugs the shoulders and says very helpful indeed, where the intended meaning is not at all helpful. Then, a lot of sarcasm is expressed by like you care, this kind of phrase, frozen phrases. Then, sarcasm is embedded in the meaning of words being used. I love being ignored is a sarcastic statement. And propositional sarcasm, this looks like a perfect plan. Many times sarcasm is expressed by non-propositional constructs, like question, for example. Okay, so rhetorical statements. So types of sarcasm has been studied in linguistics, cognitive science quite a lot. And sarcasm is also expressed by a tuple. S, speaker, H is the hearer, C is the context, U is the utterance, P is the literal proposition, and P dashed is the intended proposition. So if I take this example of I love being ignored, S is the person referred to as by I, H is the listener, say the host of the party, C is the context, I love being ignored is the utterance. In surface proposition is I love being ignored. Okay, deeper proposition is I do not like being ignored. So sarcasm is a sixth tuple entity. The impact of sarcasm on sentiment analysis has been felt.
Can you go back? Oh, I see. So is there a particular vocabulary or particular representation for context? What form it takes and could it distinguish in more sophisticated way the context? Because speaker and hearer is also a context.
Mm.
Possibly.
So one of the ways context is expressed is by the series of statements in a dialogue, for example. So an individual statement may not be sarcastic when looked at out of the context, but anything that comes before, you have to look at that history and understand that this is sarcastic.
Is there anything, any role of identifying that, oh, this thing is largely, assumption that most of the use of certain words will be in non-sarcastic context, and so this is deviant of that, and hence I need to pay attention.
So in our work on contextual sarcasm detection, we have used this idea. Yes. This is personalization, really. Okay. So the fact that sarcasm has to be taken seriously has been brought about by many other pieces of work on sentiment analysis. So we, for example, tried these sentiment analyzers called Meaning Cloud and some tools in the famous NLTK. Toolkit. So there we found that precision drops from 50 to 20 in Meaning Cloud and 81 to 38 for NLTK for conversational scripts, transcripts. In tweets, it falls from 80 to 70 and 69 to 35 for tweets. Okay. So the fact that...
Is this corpus about certain specific thing or...?
Yeah,
These are the Meaning Cloud, are they capturing something?
These are tools actually. These are tools.
Right.
And they have been trained on this kind of data. Conversation script, tweets and so on.
Because remember I was saying yesterday that I feel that there will be good chance that there will be sarcasm in the lot of sarcasm in the context of harassment or depression or other area.
Right. Right.
I'm wondering whether with the application or domain in mind you have more more or less of this sarcasm and hence more or less of impact, more or less of complexity.
Sarcasm intensity is something we have started looking into. Could be mildly sarcastic, could be intensely sarcastic. So this is one problem we are beginning to look into. Really. So ordinary sentiment analysis algorithms would fail on sarcastic text. Because clearly the surface features are very different from underlying meaning.
Actually, we sort of use sentiment analysis to determine sarcasm, right? So
yes.
This kind of looks upside down.
No, we are using components of the text which are sentiment bearing. Okay, so detecting that a phrase has sentiment or a word has sentiment that requires resource or a previous module.
But you gave an example where certain terms are used where they appear to be fact based and didn't have sentiment.
Right. So this requires word knowledge. I suggest you wear the perfume with your windows shut. Okay, so this is word knowledge. Now how we capture that we'll see as we go. So though sarcasm is a very challenging problem, fortunately for us, sarcasm is expressed by different pragmatic factors which are giveaways for sarcasm. So laughter expressions are very heavily used, we have seen from our data. Haha, you are very smart, meaning that you are not smart. Okay, so there is this haha and an emoticon, XD. Your intelligence astounds me, LOL. okay, shows that something is unusual about this text. Heavy punctuation, protein shake for dinner, 2 exclamations, great, 3 exclamations. Okay, so these are extra linguistic features which are giveaways for sarcasm. Use of emoticons, I love it when people tweet yet ignore my text, X and this symbol. Interjections, 3 a.m. at work, yay, yay. Then capital letters, super excited to wear my uniform to school tomorrow. Double exclamation, then emoticons and LOL. So this is quite characteristics of sarcastic text. People give these extra linguistic features. They have to be exploited.
So, you are just detecting sarcasm in text. You don't label that what kind of category of sarcasm.
Mm. Yeah, category of sarcasm and intensity of sarcasm. These two pieces of work. We have to start.
So what's wrong with the last one? So what is giveaway that is sarcastic? The LOL.
LOL, then this smiley and then 2 exclamations. If you're stating a fact, I'm really excited, maybe we'll stop with some exclamation mark. Okay, LOL, yeah, LOL is a giveaway. So our contribution to sarcasm research is this, that we computationally exploit incongruity. Sarcasm rests on incongruity, okay, either direct or indirect, implicit, explicit. So this is our contribution. If we take this first sentence, I love being ignored. Love has positive sentiment, ignored is negative. The fact that they are coming together is a clue to sarcasm. 3 a.m. at work is not a desirable situation. Yay, yay are positive expressions. Why are they coming together? Up all night coughing, negative situation. Yay, me is positive expression. Again, why are they together? No power, negative situation, yes, yes, thank you, stop. Thank you is positive. Okay, again incongruous. This phone has an awesome battery backup of 2 hours. Backup of 2 hours is not good, awesome is good. Okay, so we see that 2 incongruous things are coming together, either implicitly or explicitly, or even in the context. So this is the main idea which drives all our algorithms.
So many of these things are subjective. For example, my phone, if it is a kind of model for which 2 hour battery is also a good thing, then this should not be characterized as sarcastic. So how do you take care of the subjectivity?
So the whole sentiment analysis is really a subjective problem, okay? And this particular fact of 2 hour being situational. Okay.
Yeah, it requires some common sense knowledge, world knowledge.
Yeah, so I'm coming to that slowly. So there are 2 kinds of incongruity, explicit incongruity. I love being ignored, 2 incongruous things on the surface. I love this paper so much that I made a doggy bag out of it. So making doggy bag out of something is not negative per se. In the context, they are incongruous. So 2 kinds of incongruity, explicit and incongruous.
Love has intensity here, right?
Love is intensity.
Yeah.
If you had said, I like, then it would be milder. So sarcasm detection using semantic incongruity. We had a paper last year in EMNLP, and then it also was covered in MIT Technology Review, because it has a simple idea to capture lots of this world knowledge, common sense knowledge and so on. So I'll describe this work. The fact that unigrams are very useful features is known from research in sentiment analysis for 15-20 years. The fact that pragmatic features like capitalization, emoticon, punctuation mark, they have to be used, this is also known in sentiment analysis. Our contribution is use of incongruity, explicitly or implicitly, which is added to this set of features of unigrams, capitalization, etc., etc. And we show that capturing unigram could be very challenging, but if we use deep learning word vectors, etc., then there is a simple way to do this. our data sets were two kinds of tweets. Why two kinds? They have different properties. More importantly, the balance of positive and negative data is different in all the different data sets. There is an amount of skew in terms of positive data and negative data.
Isn't that a small number?
These are small numbers. We didn't need much more. That's not a So our results are that when we use incongruity, lexical, explicit, lexical, implicit, etc., etc., then we get on tweet A, we get F score of about 0.9. On tweet B, about 0.6, and on the discussion forum again, about 0.6. And these figures are better than any which is reported in the literature. So this essentially shows that there are important features which need to be exploited for sarcasm detection. Now, these kind of ideas we have tried on intersentential sarcastic situations, that is dialogues, for example. So they again need a different kind of treatment. I'm not going into that part of work. But instead, I'll move on to use of word vectors and deep neural network. So deep neural networks are found attractive because NLP itself is in layers. We have seen this in the beginning of the talk, that NLP happens in layers. And we can have layers of neural network for each of NLP layers. And this is indeed being done. There are very deep neural networks which are being deployed for natural language processing.
Are they explicitly the layers mapping to this very clean layering?
Yes.
Deep neural networks.
Yeah. So towards the end of the talk, I'll talk about heat map study of weights of deep learning neural networks. So that seem to trace back to features of NLP which are at lower levels. I'll come to that. So incongruity is very useful, which our basic machine learning based work on sarcasm shows. But how to capture incongruity? Incongruity has a lot of word knowledge, as you said. Okay, 2 hours of battery backup. It's a word knowledge. Then making a doggy bag out of the paper. This is again word knowledge. So how do we capture incongruity? We used a very simple idea. Incongruity has similarity to the notion of similarity itself. Okay, if we take this sentence, a man needs a woman like a fish needs bicycle. This is a sarcastic statement. Is from our data. So the similarity of man and woman is very high compared to similarity of fish and bicycle. Okay, so the fact that the two similarity values in the two noun phrases, or in the two phrases in the sentence, which are on the left and right side of a preposition, which is like. So like has a preposition. There is a left part and the right part. The similarity values are very different in the two parts, okay? And that is an indicator of something abnormal in the text, namely sarcasm. So this we do by creating word vectors of man, woman, fish, bicycle, etc. That is a simple idea, but the feature engineering is more complex. So we've found empirically that we have to take maximum score and minimum score of most dissimilar and most dissimilar word pairs. So this is some elaborate feature engineering, which can be seen in our paper. Then we also take into account the distance between words for which the similarity is being computed. Then we took what are called book snippets. 759 are sarcastic. They were downloaded from Goodreads website. And then we made use of some usual classifiers. So here are the results, lots of numbers, but we can see that when we go on adding the similarity-based features and weighted similarity-based features, then figures go on improving and we get a sarcasm accuracy value of about 80%. Okay, yeah.
So how do you calculate, how do you match the words for finding a similarity? I mean, you get the similarity of man and woman,
yeah,
but not man and fish.
we get
woman and bicycle, you know.
Because man, women, these are all vectors now.
No, I know.
How do you pick those two words?
I just said you, how do you mean?
Oh.
You have four words.
Okay.
You just take into account two similarities.
So this is where parsing helps. Okay.
Oh, okay.
So these are parsing helps. We get the part of the sentence before like.
Okay.
And the part of the sentence after like.
Paraphrasing.
So dependency parsing is required.
Okay.
So these kind of results are obtained about 80% accuracy, and they are obtained through very simple, you know, similarity-based calculation, making use of quad vectors, which is why it got the attention of MIT Tech Review. You know, a difficult problem like sarcasm being handled by simple quad vectors and similarity calculation. And different kinds of quad vectors are taken, like LSA, GLOW, dependency weight-based quad vectors, and so on. We'll move forward, and there is a kind of sarcasm which we have started working on, and we are pretty excited about this kind of sarcasm. About 17% of sarcastic tweets have origin in number. So this underlines the importance of doing, you know, incisive error analysis on NLP problems. We ran into this problem after we tried to do error analysis on our sarcasm systems. We understood that lot of error is happening because we are not able to handle numerical sarcasm. What is the meaning of this kind of sarcasm? This phone has an awesome battery backup of 38 hours. This is non-sarcastic. Because 38 hours and awesome are in congruity with each other. Both are positive. Third sentence, the phone has a terrible battery backup of 2 hours. This is also non-sarcastic. Two negative situations coming together. The middle sentence is sarcastic. The phone has an awesome battery backup of 2 hours. Awesome positive, backup of 2 hours is negative. Okay, so this all this data is there in the database, sarcastic data and non-sarcastic data. So an amount of subjectivity is eliminated because we are saying that we are true to the data. Okay, true to the data. So how do we handle this kind of problem? Okay, numerical sarcasm. Waiting 45 minutes for subway in the freezing cold, 3 hours of sleep is awesome, got to read 50 pages to do my math before tomorrow, I'm so excited, okay? Then minus 28 degrees centigrade in wind chill factor, etc., etc., this is fantastic, and so on. So there are positive sentiment bearing words and a negative expression which has a number in it, okay? But that negativity is not apparent on the surface. It has to be captured either by word knowledge or from the data. So this suggests a very simple algorithm which I'll talk about, but there are standard data sets which come through competitions like SemiVal, sentiment analysis, you know, competitions and so on. And we have also mined a lot of data from Twitter APIs. So a very simple rule-based system was created. This runs in the following way. We have two repositories, sarcastic and non-sarcastic. And from those repositories, we create a data structure. Okay? Tweet number, noun phrase list, number and number repeat. So to give an example, this phone has an awesome battery backup of 2 hours. We do NLP on this sentence. Do parsing, dependency parsing, etc. And then we create a structure of this form. Tweet number, phone, awesome, battery, backup, hours, these are the words in the sentence. The number unit is 2, and hours is the number unit, I mean the unit of the So, when you create this kind of data structure, okay, from all the training data, sarcastic data and non-sarcastic data, then we make use of this in a new text in the following way. First, we match the new sentence in the sarcastic repository. Consult the sarcastic tweet repository, match words in the noun phrase list. Select the most similar entry from the sarcastic repository. If numbers are close, sarcastic, otherwise non-sarcastic.
But
yeah.
When you say numbers are close, so 1 hour or 3 hours instead of 2 hours, would it be called close or not called close?
Yeah.
I mean, and without
so
without
so just
what knowledge, how do you do
it? Right, so coming to that, okay. So, So if the numbers are closed, numbers are close to each other for a sarcastic repository, then the new text is sarcastic, otherwise non-sarcastic. Say a complementary algorithm is match in the non-sarcastic repository, and if the numbers are far apart, then it is sarcastic. To give an example, I love writing this paper at 9 a.m. This is the test tweet. Matched sarcastic tweet is, I love writing this paper daily at 3 a.m. 9 is not close to 3, not close, quote unquote. Okay. So the test tweet is non-sarcastic. And other example is, I am so productive when my room is 81 degrees. The matched non-sarcastic tweet is, I am very much productive in my room as it has 21 degrees. The absolute difference between 81 and 21 is high, therefore the test suite is sarcastic. As simple as that, okay? But the whole point I'm making is that, as you asked, what is the meaning of saying distant and close, okay? What is the meaning of this? How do you decide? So when we have a rule-based algorithm, we decide it in an ad hoc manner, okay? And that's why, though our results were extremely good, exceptionally good, you can see our a rule-based algorithm produced an overall F-score of about 0.82, where reported figures from other works were only in the range of 20s. Okay. In spite of that, our papers inevitably came back rejected. Okay. Rejected for these questions. We don't believe that such a simple idea will work. And what is the meaning of close? Okay. So then, as is the story in many other fields of NLP, these ad hoc decisions, you leave it to machine learning. Okay, as I said in the beginning, many thanks is a frozen expression, get this pattern from the data. And then the world says, oh fine, data is telling me, accept it. Okay, ad hoc decision from my own head, people will not believe. If data says, well, close means, seven, a distance of seven. If data says that, community says, fine, it's okay. Data says.
Unfortunate.
So this is machine learning.
No, okay. That is machine learning, but then the problem could have been solved even with the above the thing reasonably well, with the rule base.
We could have solved, but then the community will say, you are one of the human beings, one of my peers, one of my colleagues, why should I believe in you? Okay. Either a higher power, God has to descend and say that this is the or data is our God in machine learning. So any kind of ad hoc decision, this is the principle to be followed. Any kind of ad hoc decision, give it to data. Okay? So then you get robustness, and of course your papers get accepted because data is saying.
So you replaced it by what?
Yes, so we replace it by usual, culprits, SVM, KNN, random forest.
So how did it kind of scale, like 80 versus 20 and 9 versus 3? I mean, 9 and 3 could be in the same class. So it looks at the hours and so there is some amount of scaling, right? Like why is 80 different from 20 versus 9? So 9 and 3 could be the same class if it is 100 is the range.
So I may sound a bit audacious.
How is that taken care of
I'm being a bit audacious. I'll say that 9 and 3 are far apart in one kind of context.
Yeah, that's what.
And context is the context from the data. Okay, for battery backup it is fine, but for temperature this is close. So the word temperature has to appear there in the data. The word battery is stuck in the book. As effective and shallow as that.
So, in our case, we have to look at the knowledge base. We need to have such effective knowledge base.
So, that is the classical AI. Mm-hmm. We create resources, frame net, concept net, word net, verb. No, we have seen that in NLP, two streams have always run parallel. Human created resources and data-driven machine learning-oriented algorithms. So go to the data, learn the pattern, or go to the resources, get the patterns that human beings have created.
So the magic is in that matching process.
Yes.
Yeah. So then what is the impact of having false positives or false negatives on your training data?
False positive, false negatives would come from the testing data. Right? So training data, if it does not encode all possible situations, we'll get false positives and negative, false negatives. The machine learning algorithm is as good as its training data.
So how do you detect that easily and prevent that from happening?
No, but he has good F score, so he's showing 0.8 and all that. So
from this, that's true. But this is one observation. This is a very important insight from L.G. Ballier in 1984. So there was a paper called Theory of Learning, 1984. It said that if the testing situation is similar to training situation, then your learning algorithm. A very intuitive statement, you know, a very obvious statement.
Representative.
Yeah. And this similarity of test and training situation is captured by probability. We assume that the test data comes from the same probability distribution that produced the training data. So this SVM, KNN, random forest classifiers were taken, positive words, negative words, highly emotional positive words, they were taken. And then we also made use of emoticon features, positive, negative. Punctuation features were used. And then we also used, you know, deep learning based approach where feature engineering was not employed.
Yeah, I have a question actually. So in your case, you used either the sarcastic matched one or the non-sarcastic, right?
Yeah.
But maybe making use of both would probably give you the relative scaling also, I think. And that would, you're using it already.
Which is being used in the machine learning based systems. Yeah. So deep learning uses a convolutional neural network with filtering, which are again very standard things these days. And the results are this. The first set of rows shows reported figures where the F score is in the range of 20s. Rule-based approaches give about 80% figure for F score. Machine learning-based approaches based on SVM, KNN, etc. again gives about 80s kind of figure. But deep learning gives us 90%. Okay? And we really do not understand why deep learning works so well. Like many other fields of NLP.
How was your setting for CNN?
For CNN? Mm-hmm. For CNN. Embedding size of 128. The word vectors are of size 128.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Maximum tweet length of 36 words. Padding was used. And filters were 3, 4, and 5 to extract features.
And how many layer convolution did you have?
There is only one filter layer. And there is an aggregation layer for features. Then there is a feed-forward softmax layer.
So you have a convolution of size 3, 4,
and 5. Yes.
Okay. And then you aggregate. Those.
Aggregate, yeah. And then a feed-forward network with softmax.
And how did you aggregate? Maximum or average?
Aggregation, maximum. Maximum. Okay. So, deep learning is giving good figures. So there are case studies which I'm running short of time. I'll go to another part of my talk, which is use of cognitive features, enter cognition. So we know that sarcasm is a highly body language specific phenomenon. Okay. You are an excellent person. You are an excellent person. You know, tone, the body language, that gives away sarcasm. So can we make use of cognitive features? We made use of eye tracking technology. So eye tracking machines are quite easy to get these days. Even our mobile phones are coming with eye tracking devices. So in eye tracking, what happens is that the person sits in front of the terminal, and we asked our subjects to look at the text and label them as sarcastic or non-sarcastic, and study their eye tracking behavior. So from eye tracking behavior, we capture the gaze point, where is the eye resting, fixation, what is the amount of time the eye is spending on the word, saccade, the back and forth movement of eye, and scan path, which is defined by the path connecting all the fixations. So it becomes a graph where the nodes are eye resting points the duration of the eye resting and connection between the fixation points. This becomes a graph. So these features are used, which is based on a hypothesis called eye-mind hypothesis in 1980. When the subject views a word, he or she also processes it cognitively for approximately the same amount of time he or she fixates on it. Okay, so there is a correlation between cognitive load and the amount of time the eye spends on a piece of text. So we use this feature, cognitive features, and this was a paper in 2016 last year, ACL 2016. So usual features of textual type, unigrams, punctuations, incongruity features we borrowed from our previous work on sarcasm detection. And then we added, you know, well-known readability features like flash, lexical polarity, word count. And then we used simple gaze-based features from the eye tracking behavior. And then complex gaze features, which are based on the graph theoretic properties of the eye graph. Okay. So data sets against standard data sets. The results were that augmentation of features with cognitive features produced higher values of accuracy. However, the comments from reviewers often were, this was an ACL paper last year, comments from reviewers were, what is the return on investment? Is the accuracy improvement commensurate with the machinery that you are using? So then we did an ablation study of features when we found that the duration of eye on a fixation point is an important feature. And then last year in AAAI, we had a paper on predicting the reader's sarcasm understandability. Given a piece of text, will the reader be able to understand this is sarcastic or not? So this was from cognitive science point of view. And we again captured the eye tracking behavior. And you can see that for sarcastic pieces of text, eye has a back and forth movement. Take the first sentence, I will always cherish the original misconception I had of you. So the eye moves forward, and then when it sees misconception, it has encountered a negative word, but the previous strong positive word was cherish. Okay, then it goes back and sees what is going on, what is wrong in this. So this is a very typical behavior of the eye. We capture features from this, as I've shown here, textual and gaze-based feature. And then we could predict the sarcasm understandability with accuracy of about 93%. And the inter-annotator agreement was about 0.70, which is good for NLP tasks. So anyway, and this year we have a paper in ACL 2017 in Vancouver next month, where we have used deep learning neural network, convolutional layers, for sarcasm understanding, sarcasm detection. And here, again, we have very good F scores, which are better than reported papers. So I think I'll go to some observations, which is higher classification accuracy, effect of dimension variation, effect of fixation channels, etc., etc., on the problem of sarcasm. And this is what I was mentioning to you when you talked about features at the lower level. So this is there is a very nice paper from Juravsky and Hubi, Edward Hubi and Dan Juravsky, where they try to make use of heat map idea, that is the values of the weights, to see, you know, what kind of features are prominent. And very interestingly, from the heat map, when you see the intensity of the weight values, you can trace them back to important words in the text, okay, which if we had done manual feature engineering would, and to did ablation test, would come out as important features for machine learning. Okay, so the weight values show the words which are important as features. Okay, so this is why people say that in deep learning.
Would you say more about how they did this kind of analysis?
No, it's a simple thing. We also did the same. So
how they weight different words?
No. So we take the piece of text. Okay, and we pass it through the deep neural network,
okay,
and train the system, and then look at the weight values.
What is the target task?
The target task is sarcasm for us.
So is it like sensitivity analysis where you change the weight
exactly,
and then look at what happens?
Exactly. sensitivity analysis.
Okay.
And if we sit down for some time and, you know, try to figure out what these weights represent, then we can trace them back to pieces of text which are contributing to this weight.
Ah, they get the weight of the model?
Yeah, weight of the model, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
But in case that model has several layers, how they get the weight of single model?
Yes, so this is more complex really, and very empirical. Okay, so the layers which are close to the text,
okay,
they are capturing the word properties. Now these properties are getting aggregated and being captured at the next layer, which we believe are phrase layers.
Okay.
Then the next layer is a parsing layer. We believe so. Okay, so this has to be more experimented with. By the way, this kind of knowledge extraction from neural networks is not really new. It was happening in 1970s and 80s.
Yeah.
Okay, rule extraction from neural networks. There is this line of work. Now I think I should conclude and say that AI, NLP, sarcasm, sentiment analysis, this forms a chain, okay? And there are important ideas which are running through. General sentiment analysis does not work well for sarcasm, which is why we started working on detection of sarcasm. And general sarcasm doesn't work well for numerical sarcasm. Again, an observation. And we need very rich feature set. So incongruity is a very powerful feature for sarcasm detection. And we observe quite a lot of success from data and annotation, quite a lot of success from deep learning. And many of these features are also body language specific, cognitive features, eye tracking behavior, for example. The future one consists in mining more data from the web. We are really really need deep need of, you know, large volumes of tweets, which I believe Amit's group has, and maybe we can do some joint work, you know, sarcasm on sarcasm, depression, sarcasm, harassment. Everywhere you see sarcasm present, and we have to explain the features which are discovered in deep learning. We are trying to create a pipeline where the numerical sarcasm will come at the end, okay? Because number-based sarcasm is very difficult to detect. And whatever I said are in our publications. And recently, sarcasm has been reported in ACL, AAAI, in a series of papers from us. Thank you. Note that this thank you doesn't have any exclamation LOL. So it is not sarcasm.
Any quick question? We'll have to wrap up shortly, but
okay. Well.